Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Core: How a Single Organizing Idea Can Change Business for Good, by Neil Gaught. Narrated by Shaun Grindell. Foreword. With his book Core: How a Single Organizing Idea Can Change Business for Good, Neil Gaught has bolstered the case for a radical rethink of how businesses are managed in the 21st century, and added significantly to the debate about modern capitalism. The growing realization that companies can be a force for social and environmental benefit at the same time as turning a healthy profit is surely one of the most exciting ideas of our time. It is not new, but it seems to have been forgotten, certainly in the last few decades. On the right of the political spectrum, maximizing profit is seen as the main value businesses contribute to society. Meddling with this simple objective by introducing social and environmental issues could undermine growth and jobs. In fact, maximizing profit for shareholders is a legal obligation in many countries. Meanwhile, on the left, the profit motive is held in high suspicion, but so is any attempt to muddy the clear dividing lines between the public sector, which is accountable for social progress, and the private sector, which is not. Although coming at it from different perspectives, both left and right thus share the same minimalist understanding of business. But such a limited vision for the role of the private sector is on its way out, as capitalism is rethought. Positive social impact is not the preserve of the public sector, nor are private companies the only purveyors of environmental damage. Both sectors are capable of making a huge contribution or creating lasting harm. In most countries, waiting for the public sector to become accountable and effective enough to successfully regulate the actions of private companies would mean a long wait indeed. My career working with communities on the wrong side of globalization has made me healthily skeptical about CSR. Corporate social responsibility. Seeing the negative impacts of large mining, oil and agriculture companies on communities and the environment, I have viewed much CSR as marketing dressed up as charity, often paid for out of clever tax arrangements. But over the years, I have learnt to be equally wary of flowery promises made by politicians and public sector leaders. In most countries, there is just as much money to be made in politics and NGOs as there is in business. Society cannot rely on the public sector alone to safeguard its values. There are brilliant people in all sectors of society, people committed to make a lasting and profound difference. Engaging with business as a crucial driver of positive change, while heretical for the theorists on left and right, is the only meaningful strategy for those who want to change the world for the better. Fortunately, more and more companies are demonstrating that the supposed tension between making money and making a difference is insubstantiated. It could, in fact, be the opposite of the truth. The best businesses explicitly set out to contribute to society, now often in the context of the new Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs. And to live out authentically held values. That is increasingly what is expected of them by customers, employees, and investors alike. But it can be a nerve-wracking process, especially for business leaders schooled in the more traditional dichotomy between private and public, and wary of taking risks. So, how can it be done? That is the question Neil seeks to answer in this substantial addition to the debate. He joins the list of critics heralding the end of the era of CSR. As he says, identifying the odd win-win is not radical enough. In the digital age, there is no more time for spin and greenwash. Businesses need to change in a more fundamental way. And Neil's idea of a single organizing idea, SOI, is compelling. I worked with Neil some years ago, assessing the future strategy of a major international NGO, and the meticulous and pragmatic nature of his thinking, coupled with his ambition and idealism for what is achievable, usually far beyond what his clients might think possible, is evident throughout this book. Generously, Neil shares a lifetime of business consulting experience in a condensed how-to list for revealing and building a strategy around the SOI. And he does it in an eminently readable way. And he does it in an eminently listenable way, introducing anecdotes and ideas from leaders and ordinary people in business, academia, and civil society to bring the argument to life. The opening fictional story not only helps pin down the central theme of the book, it is also a surprisingly gripping listen. Only by challenging long-held theories about the limitations of what the private sector can achieve can we build a new economic model for a new century. If the business case for doing good is so compelling, why are so many companies still acting like it isn't, ignoring ethical practices and preferring a quick buck? Sure, there are powerful incentives in play that need to be challenged by public policy change, but perhaps it is also down to a lack of vision among business leaders. Perhaps they find it hard to shrug off what they have been educated to think. Rather than being bent on regressive behaviours, perhaps it's just that no one has shown them a different way. And that's why Neil's book is important. Thankfully, most people want to do the right thing. By making a compelling argument that doing so is compatible with business growth, and by setting out concrete ways to get from A to B, this book makes a valuable and original contribution. Jonathan Glennie, Director, Ipsos Sustainable Development Research Centre. Introduction. The country director was in full flow now. She radiated passion and intensity through every word she delivered. The sheer belief expressed in her eyes lived up to the vivid portrait the senior management team back in Washington, D.C. had painted of Lana Abu Hijley, the woman they nicknamed the Queen of Palestine. "We will never leave these people. We will always be here with them. We are here for good." As she uttered these words, a spontaneous sense of both euphoria and relief hit me. This was it. This was what I had been searching for. I was on a mission, as they say in the international development sector, this time for a global NGO with a new CEO at its helm. Pretty much everything in the NGO's world had changed. While his predecessor had benefited from unprecedented levels of funding following the 9/11 terror attacks, the new CEO was having an altogether bumpier ride. The 2008 global financial crisis, new types of competition, new political masters, new technology, and a new generation of people with fresh ideas ensured that questions about identity, role and value, previously left skulking in the long grass, now needed to be answered. My mission was to help find those answers. Like many previous missions, it took me on a journey of discovery. In this instance, across four continents, and into the offices of government ministries, behind the locked doors of embassies, to the air-conditioned sanctuaries of multilateral institutions and global corporations, to the simple workplaces of civil society organizations, and into the homes, schools and hospitals of some of the world's poorest people. Before I sat down with Lana that day, I had engaged with over 200 people in one way or another. I simply wanted to know the fundamental truth of this NGO, and Lana nailed it. Consequently, on September 18, 2012, the Cooperative Housing Foundation changed its name after 60 years to Global Communities. Below the name, it proudly presented its marketing strapline, Partners for Good. But this isn't just a strapline, it's a powerful statement of intent. An invitation to unify, a rallying call and a reference point against which everything Global Communities does, every new initiative it considers, and every result it achieves is measured. Partners for Good is a powerful single organizing idea that will continue to catalyze change and help the organization transition and adapt to the needs of the 21st century. That's what a single organizing idea does. But so what if an NGO dedicates itself to doing good? That's largely what NGOs are there for in the first place, right? This book is about how commercial businesses can also adopt a single organizing idea and more importantly, why they have to. In it, I'm setting idealism aside to demonstrate the power and potential that a single organizing idea can bring to business, and how identifying, defining, and aligning with such an idea could affect changes that not only deliver competitive advantage, but benefits to society as well. The tides of change may have engaged the minds of business leaders such as Indra Nooyi, the CEO of PepsiCo, who launched a performance with purpose strategy in 2006, and thinks corporates need to catch up with NGOs, although that may not be achieved through advertising. However, the reality is that most commercial entities, the mainstream, have yet to identify what their actual purpose is, or what value they deliver beyond the often undifferentiated products or services they provide. The truth of most businesses is hidden behind their brand, and an approach to branding which is out of touch with audiences who want to understand who they really are. Identifying, defining, and aligning a business with a single organizing idea, SOI, can change that, and at the same time potentially help change the world. And it's a necessary change. The private sector, and many of the colossal corporations that dominate it, realized some time ago that we can't indefinitely keep plundering the finite resources of our planet. They're already running out. We can't indefinitely keep shifting activity to lower wage economics. Soon there won't be any left. We can't keep widening the wealth gap, because it continually diminishes the number of consumers who can afford our products. Capitalism is running out of options. At the same time, societal expectations of business are changing. People no longer want to engage with organizations whose sole purpose is to sell us things and make a profit. That seems vulgar and unattractive now. Society expects more. It gets behind organizations that are perceived to be forward-thinking and actively engaged with the big issues and topics we care about. Conversely, the businesses that seem oblivious or aren't forward-thinking enough are likely to be penalized with increasing frequency. Businesses can't keep pretending to be benign to their employees, their suppliers, and the planet if they're not. They operate in a world saturated by social media that now exposes bad behavior, or indeed any behavior that doesn't contribute to the greater good. And when businesses aren't perceived as contributing to the greater good, they can no longer attract and retain high-quality employees or investors. Likewise, businesses can no longer succeed in the long term, selling products and services that underperform. Because again, social media spreads the word, and businesses are being held to account like never before. In response to these challenges, a sizable number of academics, consultants, and commentators have formulated and published their own thoughts about what to do next. There's a wide spectrum of ideas, but among them, a lot of consensus around the fact that businesses of all sizes need to think hard about their fundamental purpose. In essence, many are saying that businesses need to revisit the idea that their primary reason for existing is to deliver short-term profits to a relatively small number of shareholders. Instead, and this is already happening, businesses should reorientate to achieve profit at the same time as they fulfill a societal useful purpose. In other words, pursue a profit and social purpose agenda. What does profit and purpose look like? Well, here's a simple example. I can make money selling coconut water. If, in addition, I pay my producers a bit more, it ensures they can invest in more productive and sustainable agricultural practices. I might even spend money to help them do so. The good news is that it's a win-win all round. It's good for me because it shores up my supply chain, so I get greater continuity of supply. Meanwhile, my customers benefit from a healthy, delicious product. My suppliers and their communities benefit from agricultural practices that preserve their environment. My community benefits because I'm providing people with jobs and wages. My shareholders are fine too. Investment in the community has been based on a business calculation that satisfies the usual business investment criteria and delivers a return on investment, ROI, that will deliver stable long-term income. This is particularly appealing to the long-term type of investor I'm specifically looking to attract. I don't want investors who are only interested in short-term risky investments. Of course, this is an easy example. In reality, it's not at all clear to most businesses what they can do or how they can change. In January 2016, at the World Economic Forum held in Davos, the Business and Sustainable Development Commission, BSDC, was launched by proactive global business leaders and civil society organizations, financially backed by a group of governments and foundations. As promised, 1 year later, the Commission delivered its inaugural report to the class of Davos 2017. In it, they laid out the economic advantages businesses would reap from putting social purpose at their core and achieving the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, SDGs. The business case for sustainable development is strong already. It opens up new opportunities and big efficiency gains. It drives innovation, and it enhances reputations. With a reputation for sustainability, companies attract and retain employees, consumers, B2B customers, and investors, and they secure their license to operate. That's why sustainable companies around the globe are thriving and delivering attractive returns to shareholders. The report lists 60 market opportunities across 4 economic systems: food and agriculture, cities, energy and materials, health and well-being, related to the SDGs, and backed its findings with figures. 380 million jobs will be created achieving the global goals, and at least $12 trillion in opportunities. It sets out 6 actions business leaders can take to capture your share of this prize. Action number 2 is incorporate the global goals into company strategy. How to do that is captured in the SDG compass, according to the BSDC report's authors. Developed by the United Nations Global Compact, the World Business Council for Sustainable Development, WBCSD, and GRI, a pioneer of corporate sustainability reporting, the SDG compass is a 5-step guide for companies wishing to align their strategies with the SDGs. Backed up by a comprehensive website, www.sdgcompass.org, that includes tools and indicators, the SDG compass is a wonderful resource. But there is an issue. On page 22 of the SDG compass guide, under the title Anchoring Sustainability Goals Within the Business, the authors state, "To be most effective, your company's sustainability goals should be an integral part of its full set of financial, strategic, and operational goals, alongside goals for areas such as sales and productivity. Ultimately, the sustainability ambitions will also be reflected in the vision, mission, and/or purpose statements of the company, thereby fundamentally and prominently tying the company's future success to sustainable development." The key word here is ultimately. To my mind, reflecting the ambition of the company in its purpose is not the final, but very first step a business that is determined to change for good should be taking. And that is the key message of this book. Pursuing the adoption of and attempting to embed the SDGs, no matter how well-intentioned, without first determining the core purpose of the business, lays it open to all the sorts of challenges and accusations the perceived bolt-on CSR initiatives have attracted in the past. What businesses really need in the first instance is an understandable, unifying, compelling, relevant, and yes, permanently sustainable conviction set right at the very heart of the business. A single organizing idea, SOI, meets that criteria. In simple terms, it's a strategic management tool that helps businesses revisit their raison d'etre and then change at a practical pace from the core outward. It is what this book is about. We begin with a story. It's completely fictitious, but much of it is based on scenarios that we will all recognize. And although the characters are purposefully larger than life stereotypes, They are based on real people I've come across. Brought together, their stories illustrate larger truths about the conflicts and challenges that are preventing businesses from changing, and on the opposite side, the forces that are driving and demanding change. The second part of the book answers the question, why do businesses need to change? Avoiding the usual clutch of overused case studies, it breaks out themes from the story and draws on real-life examples and contemporary thinking to analyze in more detail the drivers that are rearranging the world we know. It concludes with descriptions of the many positive attributes of an SOI and its potential to tackle the drivers of change and turn challenges into opportunities. The third and final part is a practical guide that will help leaders and practitioners in the field who want to know how to identify, define, and implement an SOI. It is not a quick and easy process. It requires collaboration, commitment, particularly from senior managers and leaders, as well as patience and perseverance. It also requires a proven approach, and in this part of the book, I set out in detail the tools and methodologies I have adopted, refined, and developed in a step-by-step way that draws on first-hand experience to help illustrate the real impact of change on a business. At his home in London, Charles Handy, one of the world's most highly regarded business management thinkers, said to me, "Your SOI has so much more potential to make a difference than a simple purpose. An SOI does indeed have value beyond purpose. While purpose articulates the potential the business may have to make a difference, having an SOI at the core of the business demonstrates the clear intent, and most importantly, the ability to ensure purpose goes beyond words and is implemented." I don't pretend that an SOI provides a perfect answer, and it is certainly not a silver bullet. However, it can be applied in practice, and it does work to change businesses into the sustainable, dynamic, and socially connected entities that we now really need. I'll conclude by saying that I'm not a sustainability expert or an academic with reams of research to draw on. I'm not a management guru and certainly not a visionary. I'm simply an experienced and knowledgeable practitioner who has had the privilege over the last 3 decades of drawing on the minds of many people from business, government, civil society, and the media who've talked to me about their and our world. Lana Abu-Hijley and a rainbow of others from across the planet have given me precious insights and invaluable opportunities to learn and understand. Their shared perspectives have refined my thinking, fired my passion for change, and ultimately led me to create this book. I hope you find it useful. The thinking behind SOI is well developed, but that doesn't mean it shouldn't evolve and be improved. So I am keen to learn about others' successes and challenges and invite you to share your insights and experiences, either by contacting me via my email, neil@neilgaught.com, or through my website, www.neilgaught.com/SOI.html. Part 1. A Change of Fortune. A Story of Our Times. Introduction to Part 1. What you are about to hear is fiction. It's an entertaining short story that takes place across several continents and contrasts a corporate catastrophe with the founding of a bright new enterprise. Nevertheless, as you will hear, there is more than a grain of truth behind every word. So please do read between the lines. For whatever your response to this tale of misfortune and endeavor may be, herein lies a wake-up call for any business that wishes to change the nature of its fortune. A Change of Fortune. Public hearing, the cost of heating. European Parliamentary Committee on Industry, Research and Energy. Jozef Ontar Building, Brussels. Right now. With one comment, composed in haste and primed like a grenade, the chief executive of Europe's largest domestic energy supplier is seconds away from destroying everything he values in life. Mr. Haller, would you agree that the company policies you've outlined have placed customer lives at risk?
No, ma'am, I would not.
Glancing only briefly at his cell phone, while pretending to consult his briefing notes, Tomas Haller, head of Fuel Glow, finds the send button with his forefinger. He feels no need to check the line he's just dashed out. It's only a private message on Twitter, intended for the one recipient only. Even with some typos, she'll understand why he hasn't been able to give it his full attention. Facing Tomas across the chamber, the committee chair peers over her glasses. She's been gunning for this showdown for months now. In the 20 minutes since the hearing opened, he's handled every question leveled at him without once leaving the script. Tomas congratulates himself for having personally appointed Fuel Glow's communications director, who sits one row back, and dispatches his message to her.
Then maybe we should explore the tragic case of Edith Benoit.
That name. The one name Tomas Haller had been assured he would not hear. He looks up with a start, his hand shrinking from the desk. Three men sit to his right, all of who have played this inquisition with the same pre-prepared statements. They are industry competitors, maybe, but just then this trio of energy bosses bristle like him.
With respect, says Haller, until the inquiry is complete, I wouldn't wish to comment on...
With respect to Edith Benoit's family, the committee chair cuts in,
and this time she waits until she has his full attention.
You really should be more forthcoming with your answers.
For 6 years now, Tomas Haller had steered Fuel Glow with the calm authority of a captain on the bridge of a supertanker. In his experience, the waters could get a little choppy, and nobody on board would notice. The key, he maintained, was in assembling a crew he could depend upon to manage such a massive vessel. Take the individual seated behind him, in what suddenly feels to Tomas like a gladiatorial amphitheatre. As soon as the committee summoned him to this hearing, prompted by what was frankly a provocative report linking a rise in hypothermia cases amongst the elderly with increased energy price rises, he had instructed her to deal with it. When it came to protecting the brand, Eve Granger possessed the spin and bite of a Black Widow spider.
"We're seeking to stall the Benoit claim," she had told him only the week before over breakfast at the hotel where they liked to meet. "It's a non-starter."
"Mr. Haller, do I need to refresh your memory?"
The committee chair had leaned into her microphone before pressing him once more. Not that she needed to make herself any clearer in the silence that seized the chamber. Despite his media training, with all the focus on symbolically grasping ownership of each question with his hands, Tomas instinctively reaches for his headset, as if the translator has just caused him a problem.
"Exactly when did Fuel Glow become aware that Madame Benoit was receiving treatment for clinical depression?"
the chair continues.
"What mechanisms do you have in place to safeguard the welfare of customers in her situation?"
Tomas Haller offers her a puzzled smile.
"We service millions of households," he says, as if to remind her, "not just one."
"Which is all the more reason to be sensitive to the impact of your behavior as a company," she replies, with no hint of amusement. "The fact is, this poor woman felt so intimidated by the year-on-year rise in her fuel bill that she switched off her heating completely."
Tomas Haller senses his pulse points throbbing. He wants to tell her that nutters can be found in all walks of life, but is well aware of the sinkhole of grief that would open up for him. Haller might have found himself on the back foot with this question, and in need of some support from the figure sitting behind him, but he wasn't stupid. Only recently, in fact, Fuel Glow's parent company had sent in some consultant to assess the company and report back to the president. Tomas had the guy's measure before they'd even shaken hands, and made it abundantly clear that he was in charge for good reason. Not that it really matters, he reminds himself briefly. Ever since the president turned his attention to developing world markets, Haller had been left to get on with what he did best, guaranteeing a return for the investor.
There was no way he would let the actions of one muddled old lady undo his position now, or his share price-linked bonus.
"We operate within industry guidelines," he tells the committee chair,
wishing at the same time that Eve would hurry up and message him the response he so desperately needs. After the private joke he'd just sent, Haller expected her to come back at him straight away. It might have been in poor taste, concerning the warm temperature of the building and what it would take for her to cool off, but his phone just sits there uselessly, much like Tumas at that moment. A line is all he needs from her right now, a response to steer the agenda back on his terms. Across the chamber, with her eyes on the fuel glow CEO still, the committee chair nods to herself.
"Indulge me for a moment, Mr. Haller. Let's just say we were talking about your grandmother here."
"Oh, come on."
The voice from behind him, little more than an exasperated whisper, at least confirms to Tumas that Eve is still present. It's just enough to fire up a sense of indignation at the direction the chair has just taken.
"Ma'am, that's unkind. For a company that raised its domestic prices on the cusp of Northern Europe's coldest winter in a decade," she continues, "I hardly think you're in a position to protest about unkindness. And that's what this all comes down to, Mr. Haller. It's all very well to cite industry guidelines and use them to justify obscene bonuses and salary increases. But when those guidelines put profit before humanity, I feel a duty to take you to task."
Tumas Haller draws breath to respond, only to hold the thought he was set to express, in case anger gets the better of him. Did he need to remind her that he was responsible for a multi-million-dollar organization that was answerable to its shareholders? Yes, he had a duty of care to his customers, but that was based solely on the concept that they were able to pay. It was a simple business transaction. Fuel Glow wasn't a charity, after all. The organization didn't exist to benefit society. Though Tumas knew not to get into that argument and draw fire towards their tax practices. Even so, he thinks, this whole thing was so unnecessary. Did this woman with a high and mighty attitude have any idea how many people the company employed? Without Fuel Glow, he thinks to himself, thousands of people would be without a salary, struggling to feed their families and keep them warm. For this reason alone, Haller drops the argument from his mind. As for the Benoit woman, well, that was a tragedy, of course. A grieving widow slides into a fog of despair and then cuts herself off from the world around, including the power to heat her house. It was a damn shame in Haller's view, but that didn't make the company willfully complicit in her demise. If anything, the family that kicked up such a stink should take a long, hard look at themselves. Where were they when Grandma stopped opening her curtains? For this reason, Eve had been quite correct in keeping Tumas out of the debate that followed. When a dead pensioner becomes the poster girl for an anti-fuel poverty movement, his role was to chart a steady course and have faith that the storm would weaken and fade. What he hadn't banked on was the human iceberg currently refusing to break his gaze. Laura Valk, the Baltic Euro MP charged with chairing this hearing, belonged to some democratic Green Party Haller had never heard of before Eve briefed him. In her mid-50s, he guessed, and with those glasses attached to a fine silver chain, Valk had offered him one brief smile when she formally opened the meeting. Even then, it had struck Tumas that she would be offering no further gesture of warmth. Mindful of his body language just then, Haller resists the urge to fold his arms.
"May I take this opportunity," he says after a moment, "to extend my sympathies to the family of Madame Benoit?"
"In what capacity?" asks Valk, without even a blink. "Personally or as a company?"
"As a company," says Tumas, and glares right back at her. "We have nothing to apologize for."
His response prompts a gasp from the public gallery. In his peripheral vision, Tumas notes several committee members confer, and yet this is between him and the chair now.
As a human being, he adds just to clarify, of course I am sorry.
If I may add something here.
Seated beside Tomas, the CEO of the Charente Group speaks up in a way that sounds like a university professor addressing squabbling students. Tomas has respect for Anton von der Boer, but dislikes him intensely on a personal level. It wasn't just his trim figure, full head of silver hair, or the fact that he outscores Haller on Glassdoor. Haller, 25% CEO approval rate, von der Boer, 38%. The guy just has this habit of making everyone around him feel inferior. On the upside, Tomas thinks, it takes the spotlight away from him.
It would be very easy to paint a picture of the energy industry as some kind of pantomime villain, continues von der Boer. But let's not overlook our accomplishments in the field of corporate social responsibility. No doubt you'll be aware of the recent efforts made by Charente to encourage energy efficiency in the home. Our recent campaign saw just over 20% of our domestic customers install discounted smart meters.
Von der Boer looks around, as if expecting a round of applause from the men flanking him. Haller wishes he'd been the first to flag up their world-class CSR commitments. You just couldn't argue against a company that spent a bit of cash on the community, after all. Under the circumstances, however, he's quietly grateful to his business rival. Not only has Tomas forgotten the name of the guy who runs the CSR outfit, and whether it had been outsourced to Milan or Zurich, this intervention gives him a chance to check his phone. There's still no response from Eve to his direct message, though a mounting number of tweets await his attention when all this is over. Glancing up from his home screen, drawn by a muted cough from one of the committee members, he finds Lara Valk assessing them all.
Gentlemen, she says eventually, I don't wish to be drawn away from the reason why we've asked you before this committee.
You can't just dismiss our good work in that field.
Von der Boer takes Haller by surprise with the force of his response. It's as if he suddenly lost control of the irritation and annoyance that they all feel on being paraded here. Haller notes how he's just delivered his point by curling one hand into a particularly awkward-looking thumb-pointing fist. He hopes Eve is aware that he would never make such a basic error, and seizes the opportunity to regain control of the situation. When it comes to CSR, he thinks, his guys are leaders in the field.
We provide a free domestic insulation assessment for all our customers, he begins. Ultimately, Fuel Glow aims to improve the lives of our customers.
Apart from those who are scared of you.
The outburst comes from the public gallery. It causes heads to turn. There, a young man is on his feet, looking close to tears. At once, the security guard on the floor makes his way towards the gallery. Seeing him approach, the guy extends his palms to signal that his moment in the sun is done, before dropping into his seat once more. Haller recognizes the protester. He's seen him on the TV, he thinks, a member of the Benoit family, some nephew or son-in-law, a troublemaker for sure.
I'm sorry,
says the guy, gesturing toward Haller and the men beside him.
But you're letting these people get away with murder.
Tomas can feel his heart beating hard. This isn't how the hearing was supposed to shape up. In their briefing session, prior to coming here, Eve assured him that the answers she had prepared would see him through. He glances at the bullet points, noting her line about corporate social responsibility. That was the get-out-of-jail card, as Eve had put it. Only now, that doesn't feel like such a certainty. With his pen in hand, Tomas Haller finds himself drawing a box around the line, as if to set it apart from everything else. At the same time, his muted phone lights up to indicate an incoming message. Immediately, he sets his pen down, only to flatten his palm on the table and direct his full attention to the figure addressing them once more.
If we can just return to the matter at hand, says Lara Valk,
having taken a moment for everyone to settle down. setting aside all the creative ways you reduce your tax liability, she continues, which draws some amusement from her colleagues. I want to understand your awareness of potential customer hardship when reviewing prices.
It's complicated, replies Von der Boer, like she wouldn't understand.
Valk sits back in her chair, removing her spectacles with one hand so they hang freely around her neck. Try me, she says with a hint of relish. All Tumas can do is focus on his body language and reveal no hint of the fact that he's squirming on the inside. As Von der Boer begins to outline the industry's revenue requirement calculations, he notes his phone screen lights up once more to remind him of the waiting message. This time, feeling lost and close to panic, he presses the home button. It's with relief that he sees it's from Eve. She might be sitting in the row behind him, close enough to lean down and whisper in his ear. But since dispatching that private joke to her, Tumas has been feeling entirely adrift. His push notifications icon continues to tell him he's mentioned in a lot of public tweets. Nevertheless, his sole interest is in hearing from his head of communications. With Von der Boer purposely outlining every figure in the formula, Tumas Haller discreetly opens the message. He scans the single line. It's a question, he registers, simple and to the point. But it's enough to trigger such a profound sense of dread that he looks up with a start. What have you done? Future Works Hybrid Seminar 4.0, African Union Conference Center, Addis Ababa, 5 minutes later. Bibi Okira passes through the security check with a sense of shared excitement. Having waited in line for some time, chatting to her fellow delegates, it's good to be inside such an impressive building. Looking up and around, she admires the combination of marble and vaulted glass. Outside, beyond the parade of national banners snapping in the breeze, Bibi looks out at the sprawl of buildings, trees and distant hills that define the Ethiopian capital. It's her first visit in 8 years, and the commercial district has changed dramatically. Having flown in that morning from Kigali, she hopes to grab some time to explore before her flight home. For now, her attention is focused on the impending seminar. Having developed an app to bring together farmers with micro-investors, the young agripreneur is, like every delegate, here by invitation. Placing the lanyard around her neck, Bibi checks the information screen above the reception desk. Even before she locates the details, it's clear from the general direction of movement that the key plenary event is due to take place in the main hall. Joining the throng at the hall door, and knowing that her husband would be waiting to hear from her, she fishes out her phone to confirm her safe arrival. She smiles on finding a message from him, along with a clutch of work-related emails. She scrolls through quickly, scanning for a name she hopes to hear from at any time. With nothing yet.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.